step, with every heartbeat. Jesus, let it be for you only, my whole life, all for your glory. With every breath, with every word I speak, with every step, with every heartbeat, Jesus, let it be for you only, my whole life, all for your glory. My life is in your hands, I trust it all. Trusted all to you, my dreams and all my plans. I trusted all, I trusted all. Forever I'm changed, I'll never be the same. Because of your love, because of your love. Forever I'm changed, I'll never be the same. Because of your love, because of you, Jesus. Because of you, Jesus.
Everything you are, all I need, all I need, I am forever in love. This is Thoroughfare Bible Church. It's the church I grew up at. From birth until the time I finished college, this was my home church. I've sung hundreds of hymns from this hymnal and listened to hundreds of messages about God's redemptive story. However, one particular Sunday stands out above the rest. I was around 16 years old and was sitting somewhere in this very spot. Not too close, but not the back row. The pastor was preaching, and as he was speaking, what sounded like the audible voice of God spoke to me. What I heard shocked me. "You're going to do that one day." That was the sentence, and that was the only sentence. No explanation, no reasoning, no other details. I'd like to say that I immediately dropped to my knees in holy reverence and surrender, but I didn't. No, my immediate response was this. I laughed. Thankfully, it was inside into myself because I didn't want people around me thinking I was crazy, but hidden inside my laughter was a deeper response. It was no. It was me immediately telling God how shy and insecure I was, and me telling God I didn't know the first thing about preaching. Sorry, God, but no. Well, as I finished high school, I struggled with direction and my future. I bought myself some time by going to community college, but 2 years later, I was still directionless. However, it was time to transfer. I'd already decided to head to Liberty University, but I still had no clue what to major in. So in talking with my family about my future, it was mentioned that jobs in the computer or tech industry were numerous and well-paying. So I spent my first year at Liberty in the computer science department. And I hated it. While I do love math, that wasn't fun math at all. So the school year ends, and I come home for summer break just as directionless. Directionless and unhappy. I've now finished 3 years of college, but I don't feel any closer to my future than I did than the day I graduated from high school. One night that summer, these thoughts and my lack of clear direction kept me from falling asleep. Why was it this difficult to know what to do? Why am I the only one struggling with this? All of my other friends and classmates had solidified their majors by now. Why can't I? Well, laying there in the dark, God, in the grace-filled way that God usually operates with, gently reminded me of that moment several years earlier where my direction was already given. There wasn't thunder and lightning. There wasn't an attack about how I should have listened all those years ago instead of floundering around and now wasting a year in computer science. No, just the general reminder. And in that moment, all of my fears about my surrender being directly connected with an immediate departure to become a missionary in Africa didn't seem as important any longer. My will had been broken. Not by an overbearing God, but through one that allowed me to pursue a future all on my own while gently reminding me of his desire for my life. It was then that I knew that cutting my own path would continue this unhappiness. So I hopped out of bed. I knelt down on the floor beside my bed and surrendered my plans, my future, to God. I was willing to do whatever he asked of me. It was short, but oh, was it sweet. In a way that can only be described as God's hand in that moment, all of my fear, all of my anxiety, all of my directionless thoughts were just gone. And I got back in that bed, a different person, and that different person was finally able to rest.
Well, speaking of calling, the Apostle Paul experienced his own. And it was this calling that led him to this moment in time that found him writing this very letter to, or what we now call, the book of Ephesians. It's now somewhere in the early 60s. No, not the 1960s, but like the 0060s, as in 30 years, or around 30 years since the death and resurrection of Jesus. Paul's writing to a group of Jesus' followers in order to strengthen, to build up, to encourage their faith. We're talking about what is considered the Apostle Paul's finest letter. He's responsible for most of the New Testament, but this is perhaps his best work. The subtitle, Death to Life, here gives us a big picture glimpse at how this letter might be summarized. Death to life. Sounds weird, doesn't it? I mean, we're used to life, then death, But in this book, Paul explains the process of how a person goes from death to life and why that matters. Well, last week, Josh talked about belonging as he finished the second chapter of this letter. He mentioned how Paul very clearly stated that Gentiles belong in the kingdom of God, that the kingdom of God is bigger than just Jewish people, that it's for all people, that you belong, and that I belong, that we belong. Anyone that puts their faith in Jesus is an equal part of the kingdom of God. We now start in chapter 3 here in Ephesians. Remember, when Paul wrote this, there were no verses or chapter breaks. It's just a letter, one really long letter. Let's jump in. Verse 1, chapter 3. For this reason, I, Paul, a prisoner of Christ Jesus, for the sake of you Gentiles. So Paul tells us where he's writing from, prison, but also why he's there. Paul's in a quarantine, if you will. He's confined. He's in prison. Which prison? Well, Paul was imprisoned on several occasions, so where's he at right now? Well, the common position of Bible scholars is that Paul was writing Ephesians somewhere between AD 60, 61, maybe even as late as 63, which would place him in Rome. Yet he has the ability to compose a letter to followers of Jesus living in Ephesus. He'd already spent over 2 years in Ephesus as a missionary there. You can read all about his adventures in Acts chapter 19. But now, Paul's in prison, and the emperor Nero had put him there. However, Paul doesn't mention that. He doesn't write, Paul, a prisoner of Emperor Nero. Instead, he says, I'm a prisoner of Jesus Christ. He isn't delusional. He isn't trying to make stuff up. He isn't trying to appease Nero as if Nero's looking over his shoulder while he's writing this. Nor is Paul trying to denounce his faith and say in a negative way, I'm Paul, a prisoner of Jesus. See what being a follower of Jesus gets you? Prison. It stinks. I hate it. I renounce my faith. No, none of that. That is not crossing Paul's mind here. Strangely enough, Paul thinks about his life in a different way since becoming a Jesus follower. This can be quite unusual to read and comprehend here in our context today. Many of us have way more than Paul ever did. Many of us have way more than the rest of the world does. So in a number of ways, we have it easy. Our bad day is not getting a parking spot close enough to our favorite store. Our bad day is when Prime doesn't deliver in 2 days. For Paul and for many first century Christians, being a Jesus follower brought more hardship than comfort. Paul understood that both good and bad things would happen to him, but Jesus controls his life, and he's okay with that. In fact, Paul wouldn't have it any other way. So Paul's in prison, but why is he in prison? He tells his readers why. He tells us why. He's there for the sake of you Gentiles. Just as a refresher, Jews are Jews, and anyone that's not a Jew is a Gentile. So in this discourse, many of us would fall into the category of Gentiles. Now, Paul isn't in prison for theft or murder or anything like that at all. He's in prison because of his conviction that Gentiles had the same access to God that Jews did. If Paul had been content to be a Jewish Christian with a mission to Jews, or if he'd been willing to keep Gentiles on a lower tier than Jews, he probably wouldn't have been in jail. Let's continue. Verse 2 says this, surely you have heard about the administration of God's grace that was given to me for you. Well, Paul wants his reader to know that God has appointed him to the role he's in, and that qualifies him for the role. A few verses later, verse 7, Paul says it this way, I became a servant of this gospel, or I was made a minister, depending on the translation you're reading from. Paul didn't make himself do what he does. He was called into it and surrendered his will to God's. Similar there to my story. There was a call by God and a surrender to it by me. God's grace was given to Paul in that he went from persecuting Jesus followers to trying to make more of them. God's grace was given to Paul in that it was the same grace that sent Paul to the Gentiles. He was their missionary. He was for them. And now verse 3. That is the mystery made known to me by revelation, as I have already written briefly. Paul now uses this word mystery. The mystery was Paul's mission. The mystery was why Paul sat in prison. What's a mystery? In the biblical sense, a mystery was something that was once unknown that has since been revealed. before, there were lots of questions, tons of questions, but now there are answers. Now we have answers. Paul says that God revealed the answer to him. So Paul didn't come up with this himself, nor did he hear this from someone else. No, God was the direct source of the answer to this mystery. With the phrase, as I have already written briefly, that phrase, Paul's referring back to chapter 1 in Ephesians, in verses 9 through 12, where Paul wrote this: He made known to us the mystery of his will according to his good pleasure, which he purposed in Christ, to be put into effect when the times reach their fulfillment, to bring unity to all things in heaven and on earth under Christ. Verse 11, in him we were also chosen, having been predestined according to the plan of him who works out everything in conformity with the purpose of his will. And finally, verse 12, in order that we who were the first to put our hope in Christ might be for the praise of his glory. God has revealed what was once a mystery. God did that. Now, back to chapter 3. Picking up here in verse 4, Paul writes, in reading this, then, you will be able to understand my insight, Paul's insight, into the mystery of Christ. Paul wants his reader to understand this mystery so that they will know what has changed because of Jesus. Remember last week in verse 19 of chapter 2, Paul revealed what the mystery was. Here's what he wrote. So now you Gentiles are no longer strangers and foreigners. You are citizens along with all of God's holy people. You are members of God's family. This mystery is vital to first century followers of Jesus, as Jewish followers of Jesus and Gentile followers of Jesus were learning how to be one body, how to be the universal church. And you can read throughout Acts at some of the struggles they were having. But in some ways, we're still working out this mystery, aren't we? Sometimes it's on the individual level as we doubt our new identity in Christ. Sometimes it's on the global level as we can struggle with seeing certain people as our equal in Jesus, or even a potential equal in Jesus, were they to come to faith in him. But according to what God revealed to Paul and had him share with the Gentiles, we're all equal in the kingdom of God. That no one has greater access to God. No one has greater privilege with God. No one is shut off from the kingdom of God because we're all equal, and Jesus made it that way. And that mission landed Paul in prison, and he was content with it. Well, born in 1923, this future missionary was raised in a conservative Christian family that was deeply devoted to living for Christ. Bible reading, prayer, and stories of missionaries were staples in his household. Because of this foundation, he developed a strong sense of purpose and conviction to serve the Lord. From the time he took his first flight at the age of 7, he was fixated on airplanes. His mechanical aptitude was evident early on as he undertook large projects, such as building an 8-foot sailboat or taking apart the family's car motor and putting it back together. Impressive. Well, at the age of 19, he signed up for the U.S. Army with the goal of flying and eventually becoming a commercial pilot. World War II was underway, but he was grounded, if you will, due to a reoccurring infection in his leg. He served in the Army for 3 years, and during this time became aware of the need for missionary aviators. Soon after, he committed his life to missionary work and transferred his skills to God's Army, if you will. In 1948, Nate married his sweetheart, Marjorie Ferris. And together they set out with Missionary Aviation Fellowship, MAF, some of you know them by, to open the base in Chelmera, Ecuador. Ultimately, though, Nate was driven by his desire to reach the lost for Christ. Even the Wadani, a tribe known for their unprovoked killing sprees, had a place in his heart. A few successful airdrops to deliver gifts to this tribe, or after a few of them, Nate and four others decided to attempt a face-to-face meeting. On January 8th, 1956, they flew to an area near the Wadani village and landed at Palm Beach alongside the river. Despite some encouraging initial meetings, they were all martyred at that beach when the tribesmen attacked with spears a few days later. But evangelism to the Wadani did not stop because of this. In fact, it hastened. Many in the village came to accept Christ, including six of the killing party. And one of those six men was Minkaye. He murdered Nate Saint, later, though, accepted Christ. Then he baptized Nate's son, Steve. as you see in the picture. There's Nate and Steve. Later, an adult Steve and Minkaye traveled all over the world telling this story of redemption and of Jesus who made it possible. Some of you remember back on April 28th seeing on social media or in the news that Minkaye passed away this year of April 28th. Amazing things happen when we step into the mission that God is calling us into. Well, also in Shell, Ecuador, in the early 2000s, a young mom named Luz hosted a backyard Bible study for children in Shell. There, her son realized the love of Jesus and how to communicate it to others and the importance of that. Yvonne grew up and eventually became the director of Young Life Ecuador and responsible for helping spread the message of the gospel throughout his country. Yvonne is one of our missionaries here at Mountain View. Amazing things happen when we step into the mission that God is calling us into. One young man that was impacted by Young Life is named Luis. By the age of 16, he was living on his own and getting into all sorts of trouble with his three closest friends. Well, suddenly, one of those friends stopped showing up to when they would hang out and drink and get into trouble. And one friend just stopped showing up. Well, fast forward 5 months, and this friend was at Luis's house to hang out with him. And he told him that he'd been hanging out with a new group and that he wanted Luis to join this new group with him. Well, after 3 months of consistently being invited, Luis went to his first Young Life club. He was then invited to camp, but he said, no, not going to camp. However, the day before camp, his friend continued to talk and invite him to camp. And the next morning, he was on the bus headed to Young Life camp. Now, fast forward 4 years to last summer. And Luis was the main speaker at camp, telling the campers about Jesus and his great love for them. And he also is now leading the Young Life club in Cuenca. Amazing things happen when we step into the mission that God is calling us to. What's the meaning of life? We can often think that the meaning of life is to be free, but we're actually not as free as we think we are. You have to live for something. Everybody has to live for something, and whatever that thing is that you're living for, it can enslave you, and you'll feel guilty and shameful because you'll never feel like you can live up to it. And so we just push harder, and we keep grinding. Just be true to yourself. That's today's mindset, isn't it? This is how people are forming their identities, but I'm here to tell you that there is no identity like the one that you find in Jesus Christ. It's the only identity that's received and not achieved. When Jesus' love becomes your identity, it reorders all of your loves. Things that were once so important now pale in comparison. Paul got this. He lived it. It cost him his freedom, if you will, but he gained a greater freedom. I was content to sit not too close to the front, but not on the back row. And that described not only my physical location, but my spiritual location as well. I was spiritually comfortable. Comfortable. I knew enough about God to kind of hide my spiritual immaturity and maybe sound somewhat spiritually mature, but I was not close enough. But the thing is, God wants all of us, meaning he wants every part of each of us. He wants that surrender. Why? Because he wants to do amazing things in our lives. And because of our lives, to do that, we have to move. We have to move. And it starts with surrender. God, I'm here and I'm yours. However I can serve your kingdom, I'm all in. I accept my mission. That's the incredible model we see from the Apostle Paul. The guy who used to put people in jail for following Jesus was now himself in jail because of following Jesus. But he counted it all joy. It was happiness. For many of us, our worst day pales in comparison to Paul here in prison. Yet we even still grumble about these days on social media. Paul continued on, though, caring more about the spiritual maturity of those he was writing to than of his own physical circumstances. Paul understood that amazing things happen when we step into the mission God's calling us to. And we too will find ultimate joy in life when we do the same. So, what's holding you back? What do you need to get rid of? What do you need to say yes to? These are important questions to answer today. Would you pray with me? Father, now in these moments, as you search our hearts, as you pull back the covers on things we've been hiding, and areas of our life that we choose to hold on to instead of surrender, would you fill us with maybe a newfound or a renewed strength and courage to surrender? Lord, I'm so thankful for the Holy Spirit and how it can work in each of our hearts in unique ways or ways that are unique to each one of us and where we are. And I trust that you're doing a great work right now. Thank you for continuing to work in this world through us. May we continue to be those instruments and those grace-filled instruments that you want, carrying out your mission on this earth for as long as you choose to use us. It's in the name of Jesus that we pray. Amen. Now, next week, you're going to hear more about this mystery and how Paul defines this ministry, and I think it might surprise some of you. So hope you'll be back next week as we continue this series in the book of Ephesians. We'll see you then.